Climate risk is a concern for many investors, and for good reason. There has been an unprecedented surge in economic development over the last 200 years, largely driven by the power of fossil fuels. We have correspondingly seen rising levels of carbon dioxide and other greenhouse gases in our atmosphere, and an increase in the global mean surface temperature. Further temperature increases are expected, and their social and economic effects could be substantial. From the perspective of investors, the concern is that climate change may adversely affect asset prices. For example, owning companies whose business model relies on fossil fuels may not seem like such a good idea if the world is moving toward a fossil fuel-free future. I'm Ben Felix, portfolio manager at PWL Capital. In this episode of Common Sense Investing, I'm going to tell you how climate change should inform your investment decisions. A changing climate creates physical risk potentially affecting businesses, communities, and the economy. Changing weather patterns and previously habitable areas becoming uninhabitable due to temperature or flooding are examples of the physical risks of climate change. The transitional risk of climate change arises from the response of consumers and governments to climate change. The possibility that consumers will demand a lower carbon impact from products and services, and that governments will introduce regulations or taxes designed to reduce emissions, creates meaningful uncertainty for businesses. Asset prices reflect expectations about future cash flows and a discount rate reflecting the expected return. Physical and transitional climate change risks are likely to reduce expected cash flows and increase the discount rate for affected businesses, putting downward pressure on their valuations. Another channel, separate from risk, that may affect the discount rate is the tastes of investors, as described in Fahm and French's 2007 paper, Disagreement, Tastes, and Asset Prices. If enough investors avoid allocating to a type of asset due to a preference that is unrelated to risk and expected return, the price of that asset decreases, increasing its expected returns. In a 2020 theoretical paper titled Sustainable Investing in Equilibrium, Lubosch Pastor applied this concept specifically to investors' preference for owning green assets, where green refers to firms that generate positive externalities for society, while brown firms generate negative externalities. In Pastor's model, investors prefer to own green assets, which leads them to accept a lower expected return. The model also implies that green assets have lower expected returns because they hedge climate risk. If there's an unexpected worsening of the climate, consumers may exhibit greater demands for the goods and services of green providers, government regulations could push these demands even further, and investors' taste for green assets may get stronger, decreasing the cost of capital for green firms. In all cases, green firms benefit from an unexpectedly worsening climate, making them safer to own with respect to climate risk. In theory, green assets have lower expected returns because lots of investors feel good about owning them and because they hedge climate risk. This theoretical point raises an important empirical question for investors. Is climate risk priced in the way that Pastor's model suggests? If it is priced, then green assets should have higher prices and lower expected returns than brown assets. If the climate deteriorates as expected, not worse, green assets should realize lower returns than brown assets, all else equal. If the climate deteriorates more than expected, then the hedging property of green assets becomes valuable. Overweighting green assets with the hope of profiting from their hedging property would be an active bet against market prices. Like most predictive actions in the stock market, the payoff would be questionable at best. Financial markets are the best information processing machine that humans have ever created. They align incentives for investors to be the first to bring new information that may affect asset prices to the market. To answer this empirical question, there is a large and growing literature on the relationship between asset prices and climate risk. Regarding the pricing of physical climate risk, a 2019 paper titled Market Expectations About Climate Change by Wolfram Schlenker and Charles Taylor examines whether futures contracts traded on the Chicago Mercantile Exchange between 2002 and 2019. They find that over the observation period, the predictions of climate models, warming trends inferred from futures prices, and observed temperature changes all coincided. In other words, climate scientists and market participants had similar expectations, which also aligned with the realized temperature change over this period. Another interesting place to observe the pricing of physical climate risk is in the municipal bond market. Municipalities can't relocate, so we would expect municipalities with more exposure to climate risk to have a higher cost of capital if climate risk is priced. A 2020 study by Marcus Painter titled An Inconvenient Cost: The Effects of Climate Change on Municipal Bonds finds that higher exposure to sea level rise is associated with higher municipal bond yields. This effect is mostly driven by longer maturity bonds, suggesting that investors price the long-term expected effects of climate change. The real estate market offers another laboratory. A 2019 study by Bernstein, Gustafson, and Lewis titled Disaster on the Horizon: The Price Effect of Sea Level Rise finds that houses exposed to sea level rise sell at a 7% discount to comparable properties that are not exposed to the same risk. Most of the discount is driven by houses not at risk of being flooded for another 50 years, again suggesting that investors are taking a long-term view of climate risk. They find a smaller 4% discount among properties not projected to be flooded for almost a century. The discount has grown over time and is driven by sophisticated buyers and communities worried about global warming. The authors find no relation between sea level rise exposure and rental rates, reinforcing the idea that the pricing discount is due to expectations about future damage, not the current quality of the property. Transitional risk can similarly be observed in asset prices. A 2015 paper, Science and the Stock Market: Investors' Recognition of Unburnable Carbon, finds that the stock prices of the 63 largest U.S. oil and gas energy firms fell by 1.5% to 2% after the publication of a landmark paper in the journal Nature, arguing that most fossil fuel reserves would need to remain untouched to keep warming under 2 degrees Celsius by 2050. The finding implies that fossil fuel reserves could become worthless if aggressive regulations to combat climate change are put in place. Markets reacted to the findings of the paper 3 days after it was published, despite it not being picked up by the media until much later. Further evidence of priced transitional risk is found in the 2015 paper Environmental Externalities and Cost of Capital by Sudhir Shava. Shava finds that investors demand significantly higher expected returns on stocks that are excluded by environmental screens, such as hazardous chemicals, substantial emissions, and climate change concerns, compared to firms without such concerns. Shava also finds that lenders charge a significantly higher interest rate on the bank loans issued to firms with these environmental concerns. They also have lower institutional ownership and fewer banks participate in their loan syndicate. In the options market, Ilhan Sautner and Vilkov find in their 2021 paper Carbon Tail Risk that the uncertainty related to the future climate policy needed to combat climate change is priced. They find that the cost of option protection against downside tail risks is larger for firms with more carbon-intensive business models, and the cost of downside tail risk protection is magnified at times when the public's attention to climate change spikes. The 2020 paper, Climate Regulatory Risks and Corporate Bonds by Seltzer, Starks, and Zhu, finds that firms with poor environmental profiles or high carbon footprints tend to have lower credit ratings and higher yield spreads, particularly when located in a state with stricter regulatory enforcement. They use the Paris Agreement as a shock to expected climate regulations, providing evidence of a causal relation between climate regulatory risks and bond credit ratings and yield spreads, and changes in the composition of institutional ownership. Based on the literature that we just went through, I'm pretty comfortable saying that climate risk is priced. This should be reassuring for a couple of reasons. If market prices reflect current climate risks, investors are expecting returns commensurate with the risk that they are taking. If you want to protect yourself from climate risk, greener firms may be a hedge against realized climate outcomes being worse than expected, but this hedging property comes at the cost of lower expected returns. The evidence of climate risks being priced is also good news for the world. It suggests that there is a cost of capital incentive for firms to manage their exposure to climate risks. Now, I know what some of you might be thinking. At least you might be thinking this if you've watched enough of my videos. Should we build portfolios that load more heavily on carbon-intensive firms to increase expected returns? It's a good question. If climate change risk is a unique source of priced risk, then loading more heavily to it could make sense. But this leads to another empirical question. Does climate risk tell us anything more about expected returns than other known risk factors like company size, relative price, and profitability? A 2020 paper by Wei Day and Philip Meyer Bronze titled Greenhouse Gas Emissions and Expected Returns examines data from the US, developed ex-US, and emerging markets from 2009 to 2018 for evidence. They find that measures of emissions have no reliable effect on returns after controlling for firm size, relative price, and profitability for stocks and forward rates for bonds, and that cross-sectional differences in greenhouse gas emissions fail to predict cross-sectional differences in future profitability once current profitability is controlled for. Their findings suggest that the impact of climate change on the expected returns of high-emission firms is well captured by existing prices and proxies for expected future cash flows. Sorry if that news is disappointing, but it should not come as a surprise. The market is a difficult opponent to defeat in an asset pricing competition, and while our models for understanding how the market prices assets are imperfect, like any model, they're pretty good. Models like the Fama-French five-factor model explain the majority of differences in returns between diversified portfolios, and as we've seen, portfolios constructed based on greenhouse gas emissions are no exception. If the goal is increasing expected returns, tilting a portfolio toward companies with smaller size, lower prices, and robust profitability is a sensible way to go. I describe this in detail in a video titled Five-Factor Investing with ETFs and a white paper of the same title. I'm going to leave you with an idea. There is a cost of capital incentive for companies to reduce their exposure to climate risk. Green companies, companies with low exposure to climate risk, have lower expected returns because investors want to own them and they offer a climate risk hedge. Their higher prices already reflect this. Only investing in green companies means expecting lower returns. The other companies, the ones we wouldn't call green, have higher expected returns because they're more exposed to climate risk, but that's not the whole story either. If companies turn greener over time, their cost of capital should decrease and their expected cash flows should increase, increasing their price. Why would companies turn green? Because they want a lower cost of capital. Incentives are funny like that. As an investor, it might feel good to own green companies and expect lower returns for doing so. But how about owning the less green companies too and participating in their transformation toward being greener? I'm not saying all companies will eventually align with your values. But the world's largest asset managers like Vanguard and BlackRock have been exercising their power through engagement with companies and proxy voting with the view of managing climate risk. The climate is changing. The physical and transitional risks of climate change have the potential to affect how businesses function in the future. Investors owning companies exposed to climate risk may be concerned about big losses if these risks materialize. It should be a concern, but the evidence suggests that it is a compensated concern. Investors expect higher returns for owning the companies most exposed to climate risk. With engagement and proxy votes from the largest asset managers increasingly addressing climate risk, owning a total market index fund rather than focusing on owning only green companies might be the best way to do well by doing good. Thanks for watching. I'm Ben Felix, portfolio manager at PWL Capital, and this is Common Sense Investing. If you enjoyed this video, please share it with someone who you think could benefit from the information. If you want more information like this, you can tune into weekly episodes of the Rational Reminder podcast on YouTube or on podcast platforms.